Welcome to what promises to be a really interesting session on Texas mission history, generously sponsored by Texas A&MU Press. I am your moderator, Brian Stauffer. I am the Spanish translator and curator of the Spanish collection at the General Land Office. And today we're fortunate to have two really accomplished scholars of mission history here representing two different disciplines, anthropology and history. And they've prepared two papers that I think really complement each other nicely, with one sort of looking at native labor in the missions from what you might call a sort of bottom-up perspective, and the other using what we might call a kind of top-down approach looking at the Franciscan missionaries themselves, and I think really usefully situating those missionaries within the context of the apostolic missions colleges in Querétaro and Zacatecas. Before I introduce our first presenter, I want to make a note that we're going to take questions at the very end of the session, not between papers, in an effort to manage our time a little bit more efficiently and finish promptly at 2:30. I've been told that we can't stand between the people and their mid-afternoon coffee, and so we'll try not to do that. So our first presenter is Dr. Mariah Wade, who is an associate professor in the Department of Anthropology at the University of Texas at Austin. She's an archaeologist and ethnohistorian by training, who is focused on the pre-colonial and colonial periods in Texas and northern Mexico. Her master's thesis dealt with the San Antonio missions, and particularly with San Jose and San Miguel, the Aguayo mission, and its grist mill. Aside from many published thematic articles and four book chapters related to Native Americans in Texas and the greater Southwest, Mariah is the author of Native Americans and the Texas Edwards Plateau, 1582 to 1799, from the University of Texas Press, and of this lovely book right here, Missions, Missionaries, and Native Americans, Long-Term Processes and Daily Practices, and that was published by the University of Florida. That book deals specifically with mission life, mainly in Texas and the Californias, and her paper today is entitled Native Labor and the San Antonio Missions. So, please welcome Dr. Wade.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much for being here. Here we go. Sorry. Gadgets. At the risk of antagonizing everybody at the start, and might as well be at the start, let's remember not the Alamo, but San Antonio de Valero, the mission, without which there would be no Alamo, because the Alamo is actually an accident of architecture when they were trying to find a place to seek refuge and fight. The only place that they had was Mission Valero that had sufficiently protected structures and thick walls where they could actually fight a battle. But it was a mission before that. So what I'm going to talk to you about today is those individuals, those Native Americans, that contribute to the building of the missions in general, Valero being one of them. This is a map of San Antonio from 1764, and I'm actually going to emphasize to a certain extent some issues related to the late period in the missions and some disturbing aspects of that. There was a booklet published and translated by the ladies of the San Antonio ladies of the missions
Old Spanish Missions Research
yes
Library.
Right, called the Guidelines for the Texas Mission, Instructions for the Missionary of Mission Concepcion in San Antonio. And strangely enough, it was written in 1787. And the whole book addressed the cyclical tasks of necessary to run a mission. Now, as a prelude, missions were secularized by the 1790s, so we're talking about very late in the period, and I will point out that as we go along. These guidelines obviously were written from the perspective of the Franciscan friars. It was a guideline, a booklet, a handbook to say, this is how you should run it. We have, I think altogether, as historians or archaeologists or ethnohistorians, we have accepted at face value this text that speaks to and about the different tasks Native Americans, how the missions would have to perform. We have not asked from whom they learned these tasks, these multiple tasks, how they learned, And on what traditional experiences could they, and knowledges, could they graft these new colonial practices and technologies that they were forced, or willingly or not, to learn? The second and third generation mission populations would have learned by watching their peers, and but those that entered in the first generation that entered the missions, some of them as adults, would not have had that benefit. The guidelines is a handbook of instructions and advices, was written in 1787, and that's less than a decade before all of the missions in Texas, except the ones on the coast, were secularized, and certainly those of San Antonio. Secularized just means that they were passed down to the secular church. And I know it sounds a little weird, but secular church just means the priests, the normal priests, and not the friars, not the Franciscan orders. It's a term that can be misinterpreted, but that's what it means. So why did anybody organize, systematize, and publish the guidelines at this point in time, where you are almost about, you know that it's going to happen, and you are almost about to the point of the secularization? And were there any reasons, special reasons, that had little to do with the actual organization of the mission tasks? And I will return to that question at the end of this conversation. The majority of populations, certainly those that were in San Antonio missions, that entered Texas missions, were hunters and gatherers. They lived by hunting big and small game, by fishing, and by collecting wild plant resources, nuts and berries. They didn't plant anything. They were not agriculturalists. They had mastered their environment, the resources in their environment, and if you look at most biological studies, one of the things that has been consistently shown is that their diet was quite healthy, that they were in good shape. Their teeth may have suffered from grit and so forth, but in general they were in very good shape. At the missions, they continued to maintain and use some traditional objects, such as projectile points, although I only have found, in all the times that I've searched for, one document that talks about that. They made pottery, we know that. They also used metates and manos, and probably fashioned some of them, although a lot of them were imported from Mexico. And they likely dressed skins, pelts, just like they did before when they were not in the mission compounds. And those pelts would have been not for clothing, but for furniture. Bottom of beds and chairs and things like that would have been made of leather. Archives don't talk much about that. Archives actually talk very little about a lot of things. But they were not farmers, not ranchers, not shepherds, not horse grooms, not blacksmiths, not carpenters, not candle makers, musicians, bell ringers, cooks, weavers, seamstresses. They were none of that. Yet in the mission, they performed all those tasks likely with minimum training. We should really ask, how did they acquire those specialized skills, and who trained them? You had two friars and at most two soldiers in the mission, and a few non-Indian settlers that are actually mentioned in the guidelines in the book that I just mentioned. Not likely. There's just no possibility that would have happened. Friars had to conduct the normal and religious ceremonies, and I intend to, in a little work, because this was actually quite intriguing for me, try to compute how much time they actually spent in religious ceremonies. But they had supervised religious instruction, year confession, perform all too frequent burials, as well as baptisms, marriages, write the records, very important, and do the accounts, even more important, because they were responsible for that. Time constraints must be considered. A friar's capacity for work and religious workload limited the training, limited the time for training of domestic tasks, for which they may or may not have had any knowledge. So what did a friar know about weaving or blacksmithing? Some may have acquired actually some specialized skills, but most were not equipped with that skill set for domestic chores of a mission, and some were primarily, and they stated so, intellectuals and theologians, which is what you would expect. A friar needed actually to be treated as an hacienda manager, to delegate chores and to surround himself of the appropriate and qualified people to run an efficient mission. Friars, if you think about, there was a lot of connections between settlers and at Bejar or San Fernando and friars. But friars systematically curtailed interaction between soldiers, settlers, and mission residents, which meant that the learning opportunities were scarce, if anybody really wanted to learn. I do not recall ever seeing any archival reference to someone being rewarded or paid to teach Native Americans any particular task. According to the guidelines, again, non-natives performed a few tasks, a few mission tasks. Women from Behar community sometimes washed the church linens. There were non-Indians who made saddles. They shaved the friar, probably the only person that got shaved. Performed duties as tailors, and so if you translate that literally, you get completely the wrong impression, right? Of what it meant, what their habits were or their dress was like during the early period. So I'm going to talk about ranching a little bit. So we still had one or two natives, non-natives, that were actually serving as shepherds. One thing that we know is that they were fast learners, if we take as a measure the information we get about language learning. Because Native Americans in the various missions here and in other places, for instance California, did not only make jokes on the friars, but managed to subvert their teachings by the way they manipulated Spanish. So even when we hear that they didn't speak much Spanish, and by the way, women were not trained in Spanish, friars taught males Spanish, but regardless, they had a really good command of the language in most cases, and everybody emphasizes their capacity for learning language quite in various languages quite quickly. So consider also that the first handbook, as I said before, that systematized and organized the mission tasks appeared quite late in the period. By then, and that's what really is disturbing, the mission populations would have created a cadre of native craftspeople and workers who could serve as instructors. And yet the manual reads, the guidelines read, as if no training was needed in most instances, and that certain tasks continue to be performed by outsiders, by non-Indians. The church linens is an issue of confidence, of they are being sacred objects, therefore they have to be handled in a specific way. There was also a person that made the host, the sacred host, and that was also, generally speaking, an outsider, but not always. It's unclear why, but that's the case. So the question really is how did they learn what they learned, and on what knowledge was that learning grafted? And ranching, and you can see by the hats that you're actually talking about a native population, a mixed native population, because I was trying to find a photograph that actually did not have cowboys and Indians, which is not easy, by the way. Ranching required certainly expert knowledge about seasonality, about location, about quality of pasture, about animal behavior, culling, predation, and certainly an acute sense of the landscape and its potentials and dangers, both in animal terms and in human terms, because of attacks from other tribes or other groups. And it should be quite obvious that the colonial settlers, wherever they came from, were no match for indigenous peoples in any of those aspects, because they would have been much better. Nor would they need any training in butchering, because they had been butchering animals, wild animals, buffalo and deer and smaller game, to survive all their lives. So, in terms of ranching, there's a clear trend of where that those skills would come from. But the same could not be said about shepherding, and shearing, which not only requires specialized skills, but also a complex set of tools. And those would also be, butchering would not be a problem at all. They would know very well how to do that. Filleting and barbecuing, by the way, that's where barbecue comes from. They were drying the meat way before anybody else did. They had to. But then, and again, you can go a lot further on that issue of that. No sauce, probably, but drying, yes. I have to use medieval slides with the to impress upon you the complexity of shearing sheep and so forth, because there are no pictures of Native Americans doing anything. Actually, there are very little information about Native Americans doing those things. So, but we do know that they had very big ranches with a lot of sheep. But that implies a lot of, it's difficult. You can just kill the animal and or make it bleed very badly. This, you need to know very well what you're doing. Further, all the tasks associated with the wool, the processing of the wool, the weaving, and the cloth making were completely foreign to the indigenous populations. They would have to learn from somebody that knew, and that was a complex set of tasks. It's also interesting that and noteworthy that the guidelines mention cattle rations for the missions. Every day the cattle would be brought on Thursday and be slaughtered on Saturday for meat rations on Sunday. But they never make a single reference to sheep meat. So it raises the issue whether or not we are actually talking about the utilization of the animals for meals, or are they culling the herd just for wool, and therefore you are actually, by the time it gets to that point, you actually have old, tough animals, because that's what you would do to extract the most of the wool from the animals. You just let them live a long life. While ranching practices were grafted on traditional knowledges, shepherding certainly was not. Likewise, farming required a complete different mindset than hunting and gathering did. So this is a medieval one. You can see the spindle and the spindle whorl, the processing there. It's quite similar. This is from the Aztec codices, from the Florentine codices. And you can see that there's not really that much difference in the practices. But this is from Mexico. It has nothing to do with hunters and gatherers in Texas, which had never seen any of those contraptions for preparing wool and skinning it and skeining it to be able to make cloth. So, likewise, farming required a completely different mindset than hunting and gathering. It's, you know, one thing is go after a plant that you know is in season in a certain area. The other thing is putting a little grain of something in the ground and covering it with dirt and say, gee, it's going to grow. Is it? How do I know? 6 months? How am I sure that I can get a crop of it that actually I can actually eat? So it's an act of faith. Farming is an act of faith, a real serious act. For these folks, had to be. So it's a very different mindset. So, and then there is weeding, fertilizing, plowing, planting, would feel completely unnatural to those who had relied on wild products of the land and who were habituated to harvest that which they did not sow. The cyclical tending to domestic plants, such as corn, might have resulted in rituals, as it did in agricultural societies, and yet the records are completely silent on the matter, though we know that native populations engaged and performed European customary Christian festivities and incorporated those with the native games and with the native traditions, and there was. That's one of the beginnings of this mesh, the mesh of ceremonial aspects between both societies, both groups, and both cultures. The natives also always shared, and we have good evidence for that, the products of the land with other animals. It would be antithetical to them to keep birds and other animals out of the fields, and yet there were people assigned systematically to do that. This is the looms that you would see in the Aztec world. Again, it's from the Florentine codice. We don't know what looms they used. We know that they use looms. There's plenty of evidence for that. But we don't know if this is kind of the loom that they were using or some other. This is the best I can do to show you what would possibly been going on. Now, again, I had to find a medieval farming calendar to show you the complexity of the different tasks that would be involved. That all Native Americans, because that's the population of the missions that would have to do that, they would be involved. And if you, it's kind of interesting because this dawned on me only later. When you look at that, again, plows, let me, for instance, the plows, and the harnesses for the animals and so forth, all of that would have been done by the carpenters, okay, at the mission. they don't import this. They had carpenters that did this. And the medieval farming year is quite similar to what you see in the guidelines for the Texas mission in terms of the tasks. And there you scaring the birds, right? Pruning and weeding. And actually, they did that. They had people assigned to do that. But that would be very antithetical. That would be very foreigner to Native Americans, having to chase animals away. They shared the land with them. So farming skills and use of the various implements had to be learned. And as far as I can tell, these knowledges and their attendant practices had no corresponding basis in any of the local indigenous traditions. Carpenters, as I said before, would be able to rely on their previous traditional abilities, not only as carpenters, because they as carvers of wood, I should say, which is a different thing. Carving wood is not necessarily being a carpenter. They certainly carved wood. Just 1 minute, I'm going to get ahead of myself. This is from the Florentine codices again, and it is the Aztecs planting. What you would expect, certainly with the Native Americans in Texas missions, is nothing like that. These would be traditions that they might be aware of for some reason, for communication between different groups, but that's not what they did at the missions at all, because they used European techniques, carpenters. So you do have carpenters, you do have a tradition of carving before, not carpentry, but carving. But they would be able to rely on their abilities as producers of lithic, of stone and bone tools. Because carpentry is a skill that reduces wood. You know, you get a bit drunk and you reduce wood. And in the process of making a tool, that's what you're doing. You have the same basic process for lithic tools. You take out of us a big stone to reduce it to the tool that you wish. So they would have the mechanics would be very similar. What they would need, and this is something that you also don't think about very often, and it's quite important. They were trained in terms of sharp eyes, but with an eye for geometric forms. So they would have a great advantage, because they would see, they would have mental templates of geometric forms. And knowledge of wood grain, the same issue that you would have if you were talking about stone, where the grain is really important, not to get a bad piece on the shirt and have a problem finishing your tool. So those could be grafted there. Native Americans had mastered pyrotechnology well before the Europeans arrived. We know that. But blacksmithing is different. It requires specific knowledge of the interaction between fire and the properties of metals, and different properties of metals, aside from making shapes, modeling. And the association of both would entail learning, might also entail the, might also represent esoteric knowledge, because generally makers of tools play people that played with fire. That work with fire were either had the shamanic capabilities or were dangerous because of that, and it's very likely that if it did not do that was not the case. If they didn't see it as that, that it later on you would have done that so for them, for whoever practiced blacksmithing. The guidelines are funny about that, because they're not clear whether a Native American was actually always a blacksmith, or if sometimes they had to resort to outsiders to do blacksmithing. The guidelines specified that the cook was always a male, and that has to do with the innuendo and protection, females and so forth, and problems with the males and females and the messing up that would cause. But yet the women cooked for their families and prepared the tortillas even for the friar or whoever was present that was not native. They cooked their meals. From what we know from the historical sources, preparation of meals was not a male task, and a male cook would represent a social culture anomaly. Still, the person in that job would be in a position of great power, because you would have access to the food, to the food resources, and particularly you would have access to the sweets. And it appears from the friars' different documents that there was a great deal of interest in sweets. Probably the most visible. Grinding and tortillas, still the same tate mano, you know, I mean, whether it's in that fashion, this is a South American, more likely with legs on it, but that's the same tate and mano that you would see still being utilized in a lot of places. If you go to our lab in archaeology, I can show you a whole bunch of them, I've been collecting them. And so it's a simple process, but an intensive labor. Not so much the making of tortillas as it is the grinding of the flour. But probably the most ubiquitous and the most visible aspect of the missions. So yeah, there we go. Also medieval, can't get anything like that. Women did that. Is the masonry buildings. What the missions became, but late in the 18th century. Before that, those buildings do not exist. They are very, very, very slim and a very, very precarious in their shapes and in their walls. None of this majestic stuff with big walls, big defensive walls, exists until post 1758. And in my opinion, and I've said that before elsewhere, it's a result in the 1760s when this process starts. It's a result of the attack of the Mission San Saba in Menard that brings about this remodeling and this notion of protection with very thick walls. And it has relatively little to do with the Apache, by the way, who always get a bad rap, but has a lot more to do with Comanche and Norteño groups that are coming down, and therefore have a great deal more influence on what's going on in terms of conflicts between natives within the missions and obviously the Spaniards, the colonizers, but also natives outside of the missions. So these remodeling post 1758 and well-intentioned reconstructions, like for instance, this is the Alamo, or one of the five or six drawings that was prepared for in the 1930s by an engineering firm in Texas that were deciding what the Alamo should look like. And then they decided on that you see. This is one of the drawings that could have been chosen. Yeah, exactly. So that was the Alamo by then. The question was not about Valero by then, it was what the Alamo would look like. The natives that built these missions were not architects, were not engineers, were not masons. In fact, the archaeological record shows that there is almost no architecture in Texas in late prehistoric and historic period until you see the Spanish material, because the only things we have is the Caddo in East Texas, which is thatched roof architecture. We're not talking about stone. In the Panhandle, you have some rudimentary stone structures, very rudimentary. And then you have the dwellings at El Paso, which are adobe, which a different kind of construction. So what you have, it's none of these. What you have in San Antonio is really very different from anything else in terms of the work. They also built, clean, repaired bridges, the dams, the secures, as well as their own dwellings and the buildings associated with the missions, which include granaries, which include San Antonio, San Jose, San Miguel, Aguayo, watermill, and the kilns also that they had. The kilns may not have been only for, or may not have been for pottery, but they certainly were for lime. There's a good example of that. We know that, because it's a problem, the records don't tell us who did all of this, but we know that they engaged Tlaxcaltecan or Tlaxcalans craftsmen to build some of the missions or some aspects of the missions. But regardless of the amount of work and expertise to build those stone, and regardless of how much the help they got, to build those stone structures would have been an immense labor. I mean, look at them. The architectural design of the missions required specific expertise of which we know nothing about, and the work of masonry, from quarrying to shaping the stone blocks would require expert knowledge to be able to do that. And this is a difficult issue because not anybody can do that. And any of you that have any familiarity with cutting stone and so forth would know that that requires expert knowledge. The same can be said about decorative elements, like Schuchard's painting of San José San Miguel Aguayo Church, the Aguayo, the San José Mission. That's a recreation in a painting on the basis of plaster that was found, pieces on the outside that actually show that would have been covered, that would have covered the outside of the church. But you also have examples from the inside. I wonder if anybody has calculated the square footage of the frontal area of Mission San Jose, because it's a huge area and I think it would be worth doing. In and around Mexico City and the area of Tlaxcala, I have seen, traveling there, the front pieces of churches and the interior too, and in some cases what looks like stencil but may not be stencil, the designs are still in black and white where the colors would have gone. So this was a process. They bring in technicians and artists from the south and train the people that were there. We don't know. Nobody says anything in the records. Also, to do this, they would have to do scaffolding. There is no way to get up there. So we also don't know what kind of ingenuity they used to do all of that. We also know that missions, we know that a good deal of people had to be involved in these projects. And even if several of the missions were involved, it would still require a good number of people. We also know that missions at any one time did not have more than 250 more or less people, residents. And therefore, even with that for all the other shores and engaged in that, that would take a lot of people, yes. Thus, the notion that friars went to the interland and they did to round up the natives to be Christianized, which they did, has to be pondered with the caveat that they could not run a mission with less than 250 people. Otherwise, they would have to close the mission or the mission would not be viable. Rafael Oliva, also at the end of the period, recognized the issues of being a friar, a theologian, and having to be a manager of the missions. So, and he spoke to these interconnections between economic issues, the viability of the missions, and a mission to Christianize and its processes and objectives. A friar was only as good as his managerial skills, and these skills had to include guaranteeing and harnessing native labor. Oliva's statements of discontent and with the conundrum that the friars were faced was also written in 1788, so it's a year after the guidelines were written. These introspective writings and managerial compilations, as well as the final monumentality of the missions at the end of the mission period, become conspicuous because do they represent a last effort to correct the record, or are they preventing or trying to mitigate the process of secularization that was coming? So one more thing, I would be remiss if I did not discuss the socialization processes that these new skills enable and produced. The socialization process is associated with the learning and the performance of the tasks introduced at the colonial missions had to fundamentally alter indigenous concepts of and perception of space, time, seasonality, performance of labor, group constitution in general, and in particular in the assignment of tasks. In sum, they rearranged individuals' relationship to the cosmos, to the environment, and to social life. Missions were literally incubators for change, and native labor at the missions was the central core of that social change that actually was enacted. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. White, for that really interesting paper. And thanks for staying just right, exactly right in terms of time. That really helps.
It's 25 minutes, right?
I don't know.
30 to 35.
30 to 35? Yeah. Can we go to 40? No? Okay, go ahead.
Okay, so we're gonna move on now to our second presenter in this TAMU Press sponsored panel on Native Americans and Franciscans in Texas. Our second presenter is Dr. Jay Harrison, who is a member of the history faculty at Hood College in Maryland, where he is also an appointed faculty member in the Shirley Connor Hardin Center for Global Studies. He previously served as director of the Center for Southwest Studies at Fort Lewis College in Colorado. Harrison completed his graduate training in early modern history at the Catholic University of America. There he studied cultural developments in late colonial New Spain and in the early American Southwest with an emphasis on missions, missionaries, and indigenous peoples. He's currently finishing a book-length prosopographical study of the Franciscan missionaries in Texas, in which he examines their expectations, their training, their lived experience among Native peoples. His other research addresses the Native experience in the missions, particularly that of the smaller bands whose survival depended on alliances with other regional peoples. His paper today is entitled, For the Service of Two Majesties, the Franciscans' Goals in the Texas Missions.
All right, Doctor. Thank you. So let's test this. Is this live? I've got one right here. I think we'll probably get a lot of interference if we do that. Okay. You can hear me. Yes, that's excellent. Well, thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Stauffer. Thank you to the General Land Office for giving two people who study the colonial period a chance to talk at a conference on the Alamo. We very much appreciate that, don't we?
Yes,
we do. Okay. All right. So I have a few caveats. Though I studied the Franciscan missions, I studied the peoples who lived in them, I studied the 181 plus friars who ran these missions after trying to set them up and sort out all of that. This is actually the first time I've ever spoken about the missions in San Antonio, Texas. So thank you for that. My work in recent years has split, as Brian said, between studying the friars and studying the people to whom they directed their mission. And I follow in the footsteps of Dr. Wade and several other very fine folks here in Texas and elsewhere who have addressed the Native world in Texas at that time and have informed a lot of my work. The project that, the book that Brian referred to seeks to fill a gap in our knowledge about the missionaries who worked in the north of New Spain. And that is, what exactly they thought they were doing, how were they trained to do it, just where were they coming from? And though we have several excellent books, Dr. Wade's is one of them that talks about the function of the missions and is comparative across this landscape. For Texas, we need, I think, a little bit more depth on just exactly how these friars thought they were going to go about their life. And so what I'd like to talk about today comes out of some of that research, some of which examines the goals that the Franciscan friars had for Native peoples here in Texas and their missions that they worked on here, and also how they measured that. And part of this goes to the mentality. That's a scary word for historians to use. How do we measure historical mentality? There's a whole body of literature on that, so I'm not going to touch that too much, but we'll bump against the edges of this. So to put this in perspective, I want to start with a slide that takes us out of Texas. I'd like you all to ogle my beautiful title page here. Okay, that's enough of that. This is the world of the Spanish friar. That is the worldview, at least this is where they saw their influence in the world. And so to put Texas up there as most of you can, it's not even labeled. Just go east of Santa Fe a few hundred miles. That's the borderlands of Latin American history and North American history, my friends. I'd like to give you just a short primer, if I can, on the way things worked at the time of the Texas missions before 1689, 1690, when the idea of planting missions in Texas came to be. There were, of course, for several hundred years, the presence of regular orders in Spanish America. The Franciscans arrive en masse in 1524, following one or two who had been there before, Pedro de Gante and some of the ones who came with Cortez. They of course arrive in the Caribbean. And after that, we have a rush of Dominicans, and then Augustinians, Mercedarians, and after 1572, the Jesuits arrive also in New Spain or colonial Mexico. So these are the folks in which the great missionization was to occur, or with whom. Secular priests, as we've discussed, these are the diocesan priests. There was a very rare creature in colonial Texas, and that was the diocesan priest. There were a few. I'll mention that a little bit later. Most of the folks that we're going to talk about today, in fact, all of them, lived under a rule, and that's where we get this word, the regular. Regula, or the orders. So we think about St. Benedict, St. Francis, St. Dominic. This is the world we're looking at. For those of you who are experiencing a flashback to any religious education that you occurred, trust me, this will be over in just about 4 minutes, and we'll move on. So the friar specifically, a special kind of priest, a special kind of church person, one who committed to live under a rule and to be cloistered, except for moments when said friars would go out in twos and threes and fours and preach on street corners in medieval Europe. They formed to counter threats of heresy in Catholic Europe, the Albigensian scare in southern, to quote the papacy, in southern Europe, the Cathars, another way of describing that. The Dominicans are a major response to that, and of course St. Dominic and the Order Predicatorum, should have you chant that a few times. The Franciscans, the Order of Friars Minor, Fratrum Minorum, and their foundation dates, which is a period because of the multiple rules and interesting relationship the Franciscans had with the papacy. Among the Franciscan family, we find conventuals, that is, those who, as we wrestle with the idea of Lady Poverty and the expression of Franciscan living, are willing to make some compromises on just how it is that one establishes friaries and convents and the structure of the order. The observance, which we'll find to emerge as the most dominant force in Iberia at the time of the founding of New World missions, dominated by observance. The observance are those who are closer, at least in their words, to the Franciscan rule, the letter of the law, if you will. And of course, later functions and splits in the order produce the Capuchins and yet more. So the question we should ask is, why Franciscan friars? Why were they so often applied to the missions, either in the center of New Spain or out there on the frontiers? One of those reasons is the meaning of the word mendicant, which means they're beggars. And you don't have to pay a beggar a whole lot to go out to do work. I once held a fellowship with the Franciscans, and I'll go on record publicly to say that that was not the most lucrative fellowship of my career. They also were in very well with the crown in Spain. That is, that like the Jesuits, the Franciscans were also there. And following the reforms of Cardinal Archbishop Jimenez, the Archbishop of Toledo, and the Primate of Spain at the turn to the 16th century, the Franciscans were in a unique position to be in a place of power when it came to spreading Spanish Catholic culture to the New World. Now, just a note, there is a body of literature, especially when we're talking about the 16th century, that focuses on millenarian or millennialistic aspects, those are different, of the coming of the next age. And there was some tendency within the crowd of early Franciscans to associate this with, for example, the Joachimite prophecies and some of these other, not exactly fringe, but unique aspects of Spanish Franciscanism. But that was not the norm. And in a recent book, one of my colleagues has postulated very nicely that there was no such thing as a single type of Spanish observant Franciscan. And so one of the things that makes this work fascinating is just how many ways that they invoked the Franciscan approach when they went to missions. This, I swear, is the last slide about the church. Franciscan family in Mexico consisted mostly of provincial observantine Iberian friars. Following 1524, there was a burst of activity in Mexico, and as a result, there were friaries built in town after town. Franciscan churches. It was something of a spiritual arms race, if you will, between the Franciscans, the Dominicans, the Augustinians. And if you travel through Mexico, as you well know, you find these on every other corner. They're not alone, though. And as the Franciscans had their influence on New Spanish society, convents are set up for nuns, the poor clares, or the clarissas. The third order is the way to be buried, according to many. That is, that you want to be a lay member of the Franciscan family. To be buried in the habit later on in Mexico is something to be desired. And then there was a later reform between Spain and the New World. In the 1680s, permission was granted to re-engage an apostolic mission that effectively had been shut down for the Franciscans with the secularizing of proto-parishes or doctrinas in the center of Mexico. And so this last part of the Franciscan family is what we're going to concentrate on today. That's where we're going. Thank you for watching this part. I refer to these folks as the collegiate friars. That is, they come out of apostolic colleges set up with the first one in Querétaro in 1683. That's the College of the Holy Cross, La Santa Cruz. And then several others every decade or so for a number of other decades. And so the two that influenced Texas, I'll show you here in a second. First being the one in Querétaro, Mexico, and the next one being in Zacatecas. There were also a few other influences. That is the college you can still visit today in Querétaro. The cross is still there, and on any given Sunday afternoon, you have to elbow your way through that front door. Most of the documents have been moved out, but for many years of the 20th century, the documents still remain for Texas missions right here in this college, as they did for this one in the small village of Guadalupe de Zacatecas outside of the mining town of Zacatecas, north of the Sierra Gorda and up in the rich lands, mining lands of the north of Mexico. So these are largely the two colleges who would send friars up to Texas. I like to start with this slide in terms of Texas, just to point out what I've been telling my students for a number of years. Does anybody see what it says right up there in that empty space? The great space of land unknown. What do you think about that, Dr. Wade? There were lots of folks up there, and I believe they knew who they were and where they were. But that's where we're going here, the southern drainage of what's now our state of Texas. Here on that map, that is a darn good question. I don't think I have it. It is in English, yeah. So I should say this map came out of the Cutter map collection from the Center of Southwest Studies out in Colorado. What's that?
It's about 1777.
Thank you, sir. Which for the English speakers, they still considered that a great space unknown. And yet, Spanish maps would fill that in well before, some that you've already seen. All right. So just a timeline. Why Texas? Well, this is a story that many other folks have told and even talked about at these Saving Texas History conferences in the past. You heard some of that this morning, so I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on it. But I do want to point out, just as a note to what we heard this morning in the excellent talk on the Tejano experience, that the first missions to be erected in Spanish Texas were not here, but they were to the east, and very little remains of them because they were not built of stone, they were built of wood. And if you've been out there to East Texas in the Piney Woods, that's the territory we're talking about. 1689, the Spanish reactions to French incursion, 1690 to 1693. The first literature that I examined today comes out of this period, a very hopeful period in 1690 in which friars said, we will erect new missions, and this is what we will do. That was followed by a very sad perspective a couple of years later by the Franciscans, in which the Caddo people said, no, you will not, and we'd like you to leave. And they literally buried parts of the missions and walked away. There were attempts between 1693 and the mounting of an expedition to return in 1716. In fact, there was actual physical reconnaissance in 1709. And a volume that Frank de la Teja put out with the Texas Catholic Historical Society a number of years ago contains some of the records of this reconnaissance and a few others, if you'd like to take a look at that. So, secularization, the attempts, effectively began in the 1780s and were successful in the 1790s. That's when you see some of the secularization of missions being turned over to their inhabitants and the church being turned over to the diocese, 1793, 1794. But other missions were still active. And in fact, down on the coast, additional missions were being planted. Not too well, but they were being planted. So this is some of our background. I'd like to show this slide just to point out that Texas did not develop in a vacuum from the Franciscan's perspective. What you can see here are pathways, and if you follow those white lines down to the south, even south of Durango there at the bottom of the map, what you have here are the communication channels of Franciscans in these communities. Those roads transported communications back to the colegios, to those apostolic colleges. And they shared those communications, and they made copies in their cartularies, and they sat them in their archives. And over the years, especially after the early 1730s, when a new college is founded right outside the walls in a little hospice, San Fernando de Mexico, in Mexico City, that is the end point at where a lot of this communication flowed back to Mexico City and then back out again. And so keep in mind, as I show you some of the documents, which is the next part we're going to do, or at least some of the quotations, keep in mind that these are the ways that this is moving. Just a brief word about their methods and motivations, which of course inspires a lot of my work. There was a Nicholas Kushner wrote about Jesuits a few years back, published a book with a great title that said, "Why Are You Here?" Which I can only assume is directed to the Jesuits in that study by native peoples, standing right there outside of their house, asking a very appropriate question. The early missions were called doctrinas, and the Franciscans were, in the 16th century, were doctrineros. Those were more or less stable mission sites. Later missions are referred to as misiones. But in the 18th century, more and more, I've seen references to something called conversiones. That is, sites of conversion. And we can think of this conversion in the Franciscan perspective among these collegiate friars as a holistic conversion to a form of Catholic Spanish lifestyle. And so what we've heard already from Dr. Wade is highly applicable. We have to ask the questions, how are they trained to live this agricultural life, the life on an hacienda? We can also compare the Franciscans of the 18th century to the Jesuits of the 17th century, in which the Jesuits figured some of this out and then they wrote it down. And if you go peruse the libraries of these Franciscan colleges, one of the lovely things you'll find is sharing between the religious orders, which is quite surprising in the Spanish context. Franciscans and Dominicans back then did not like each other. But the Franciscans later in the 18th century decided to especially, I suppose, once the Jesuits left, to take their library and put it to good use. Personal reasons were varied, and my good friend, David Rex Galindo, talks about this in his study. I encourage you to look at it. His book will be out probably this next year. Reasons of piety, reasons of saving one's own soul, but also reasons of empire and forwarding the position of the Spanish state. So one of the other innovations that comes about is this idea of the settled mission, and I've written some on this and published in recent years. The idea, going back to the word congregar, that is to congregate, to amass, and to move people in, and some of what Dr. Wade has been talking about is that very activity, especially for peoples who are not sedentary. It's one thing to approach the Caddo peoples, the Hasanai Confederacy, and so on and so forth. It's a very different thing to deal with hunters and gatherers, Kualhuatecan or otherwise, different bands and groups of people. And so the congregation of people in the missions is one of the primary aspects, and I wrote down Fray Oliva's commentary as well in my notes, because one thing that comes out of that is the idea that the Franciscans should promote the concept of the common life in the life of the mission. That is, that this ideal Christian community of native peoples, what another eminent scholar here in Texas has referred to as nascent Christian towns of native peoples, this is a core of what a core idea of what they're doing. And we've got to be careful because that does make them hacendados, that is, estate managers. So let's look at some of what they say. 1690, the leader of the Franciscan aspect of this early contingent, Fray Damian Massenet, the conversion of those poor infidels, and I actually don't translate that infidel usually heathen, or I just leave it as the Spanish original, infieles, those without faith, or those without our faith, redeemed with the blood of Christ, our life, and for lack of ministers, an inestimable number of souls are lost. That idea of loss of souls drives a lot of the Franciscan justification for their efforts, be it in Texas or Sonora or Alta California or all the way down to Mexico City in the Indian parishes of that great city. His co-worker in this action, 1691, this is still the period of hope. 1692 is when their hopes will be dashed. Fray Francisco Casañas. The creation of vassals and towns that would be the glory of both majesties, for that of heaven and that of the earth. This is a phrase I see repeatedly. Most often it's directed in letters to the viceroy back in New Spain or to well-heeled donors in later periods in the mission time. But it also appears in letters friar to friar, especially from a missionary in the field writing back to the Father Guardian and the governing council back in New Spain. Now we get to some of the good stuff. We've spent a lot of time in recent years, Frank de la Teja most recently, talking about Fray Antonio Margil de Jesus, one of the beatified, or at least elevated friars, not canonized. But he was one of the leaders of the reestablishment in 1716, 1717 in East Texas, and then of course in 1718 with the founding of Texas, or of San Antonio River missions. That the New Philippines, which by the way, if you didn't know, that was the original name of Texas. That doesn't sit very well, does it? I claim some Texas nativeness myself, and that bothers me. Be conquered for the greater glory of God in the name of our Catholic monarch. The idea of the spiritual conquest lives on right here in the words of the otherwise docile and peace-loving Margil. When he sat down to write with another very well-known chronicler of the Franciscans, they wrote this together, Isidro Felix de Espinosa with them, that their role is to cover the Indians' nakedness, to teach them to cultivate their lands, and to raise cattle for their sustenance. Yet again, a very practical approach to missions. This is not just the conversion of souls. It gets better. To quote Fray Espinosa, yet again, he wishes that towns be congregated, the holy faith be planted, and our King and Lord be obeyed. The viceroy giving credit for having wrought this, wait for it, spiritual conquest, in which so many souls may be saved and God known. This next piece of text is very fun to translate. He uses the word reduce, literally a translation of reduce, that we reduce souls to this next word, which I have put up here as community, but can also translate as the bosom. That is the protected fold or the protected comfortable center of the church's community, of our Holy Mother Church, and the subjection to the gentility of the royal crown. He was writing to the viceroy, I should note, and so he added that last part. These are the documents that are spread throughout various archives, the Archivo General de la Nación, the Fondo Franciscano, Archivo Franciscano, down in Mexico City, and then some of the convent archives as well. Now, one of the things I'd ask at this point is, but isn't this early? Well, let's go take a look at some later commentary. One of my favorite pieces is from the Guardian Council of Santa Cruz College in 1748 at a point when their attitude towards the Texas missions was still one of hope. This is before Saint Sabah. This is before the 1758. This is before the failure of the San Javier missions that were erected between 1748, 1752, and 53. So in 1748, Guardian and Council, that is the leadership of the Santa Cruz College, it's very explicit that the missions received, the friars in the missions received that critical charge of propagating our holy faith among the barbarous nations. And again, you can translate infidels to infieles. That is the purpose of our missionary institute. What I argue that makes the Texas friars unique, and then later those that would do Alta California, Upper California, those famous chain of missions out there, is that they were married to this idea of a missionary institute attached to their specific apostolic college that was outside of the larger governance of the provinces, the Franciscan provinces and hierarchy in Mexico and elsewhere. In the words, they were fathers, teachers, caretakers, spiritual mentors to neophytes. This is a fantastic piece of text by Fray Benito de Santa Ana in 1743, saying that literally his job was to take up the hoe, the axe, the adze, the spade, and the hammer, and to show these people, to what you were talking about, just exactly what they needed to do to live a life acceptable and converted. Let's briefly talk about their measures now that we've looked at their goals. If you were my students, I would subject you to 2 hours analysis of this. We're going to take about 5 minutes. You're welcome. They're both quantifiable and qualitative measures, and these appear throughout the text. Number of neophytes in the mission populations. As you can guess, the Franciscans had to avoid over a very long period in the 18th century a feeling that they were failures, because the number of native peoples who inhabited the missions was constantly fluctuating and peaked at very low numbers. Compared to the missions elsewhere, the Texas missions were among the smallest mission populations in the New World. They looked at baptisms and marriages. They looked at agricultural and workshop outputs. They discussed, especially in the 1787 document that Dr. Wade references, how they distribute material goods and why. There's a visitation in the records down in Mexico City of a friar visiting and checking up on doing the canonical required inspection of the missions. And here's what they counted. Ganado mayor, which is large animals, right? Cattle, horses. Ganado menor, sheep, goats. I suppose the spare cat here and there.
A dog.
Dog, yeah, lots of dogs. And then they counted people. And they did this in three lines connected to one another with no distinguishing between. And this, I think, is indicative of the perspective, how we quantify the success of the missions. And then another thing that's unique to, especially the San Antonio River missions, is just how many native peoples coexisted side by side to make a new community within these places. And this is one of the pieces of my research, and I know Mariah's as well over the years, is to look at what happened and as these people came together, linguistically and otherwise, their practices, their daily work. The qualitative ones would be how well I, as a friar, approach catechetical work, that is, teaching the doctrine of the church and translating that to the people that need to know. How many lives I could write back that were changed, or at least upright lives, upright mothers. They revered mothers, although they did not have much interaction with the women in the missions. Donados, and I put that in quotes because they were not official donados, that is, young men who had come in and do work in the missions, but they did have a practice, and that's in the 1787 document as well, to keep young boys in the friary, to train them to essentially be models. Others have written quite a bit about this. And then how well they're defended. How many Ladino, that is, Spanish-speaking native peoples, were in each mission? And then whether or not functioning native polities, that is, actual small towns, developed. So I just want to point out a few things. Here's There's that brown. This is a rather interesting statue of Fray Antonio Margil de Jesus that appears as you walk into the friary in Zacatecas in the Colegio Apostolico. And I have to admit, if the light's right, it's a bit eerie.
Is that Margil?
What's that?
Margil?
That's Margil.
Oh, Christ.
Yeah, it's okay. Yeah, and you can see they've dressed him in a present-day tie around his surplice because his cords are actually in the archive, the original cords. This is a map I love to use, courtesy of the University of Texas. Thank you to those of you from UT. This map is highly useful. It's been around since 1976. Well, what makes Texas a unique experience is that while we might have those San Antonio River missions here, there were upwards of 37 attempts to establish missions within the boundaries of the present state of Texas. There were possibly more. Some of the documents we think were destroyed during the Mexican Revolution between 1910 and 1920. So we might know of other attempts, but some of those were dramatic successes, and then some were dramatic failures. You know, I knew you'd show a picture of masonry, so I wanted to do it too. If you go to Mission Concepcion, just like if you go down to San Juan Capistrano, you can take a look today and get a feel for just what sort of environment they wanted to set up. And the one I like to point out is this particular case in which the friars write back to their college and says, you know, we need a manual. We need instructions. We would like you to explain to us how to communicate the order of the Mass, confession, other sorts of penance. How can we communicate? What are the languages? Supposedly in the Apostolic Institutes, they were supposed to learn the languages. There was time set aside for the discussions of languages. That was part of their canonical charter from the papacy. And they did. They spoke Nahuatl from central Mexico, Otomi, Tarascan, some others. But very few times did they actually have a chance to communicate, we think, native languages from the very distant frontier. This is one of the few examples we have, Bartolome Garcia's document, in which we do have directions written down for Texas. The other one is the 1787 document. And there's actually also a compilation, a language loss, if you will, that predates this for the Pahalat language. This is what a friar would hold in a hand or study at night before going out the next day and performing a certain act, whether it's an act of contrition or leading the singing or whatever, right here at San Francisco de Espada Mission. So at Espada Mission, this was its destination. They asked, they received, which is a very rare thing in that day and age. And so as people perambulated around the fabric that is the layout of the mission, that was a place that we could apply this. Now, there were friars who had issues, and I'm writing about that. They had problems being up in this area. Some of them were filled with holy zeal that we cannot doubt, as they describe it themselves in their actions, such as Fray Mariano de los Dolores y Viana, very famous one up here. But others had issues. Beautiful document that I came across in the archives a number of years ago has this letter to the Holy Office of the Inquisition in Mexico City, in which the friar looks out from probably the upper level at San Jose Mission and sees nothing but sin and iniquity everywhere he looks. You don't have to laugh at this. And he calculates in this letter, obviously it spent a lot of time counting his footsteps from Mexico City or from the college, just how many leagues it is to Saltillo, the next civilized location down the Royal Road, and how far it is to the Holy Office of the Inquisition. And then he pleads for faculties to clean up Texas. Others were homesick, and they wrote about it. Others were insubordinate and ran up large bills with the authorities here in San Fernando de Béjar while trying to establish illegal missions out in the frontier. What I want to close with, and this will take me just a minute, and we can get to some questions. It's not that image, but you might as well see it. That's a typical hakau or hut. Yeah, that's a typical way that these native peoples lived. And so when the friars are going out to administer their work and interacting, this is oftentimes a place of interaction. Okay, this is what I wanted to show. This is not Texas. This is actually an idealized view from California. But I think it speaks to the Franciscan mentality. What you see if you look in this image is a community at work. Now, if you look closely enough in that grainy image, you'll see two friars. One of them has the tonsure exposed, the other one is wearing his hood. Again, the habit is there as it should be. This is the view that they carried in, that they idealized. There was a questionnaire written by Fray Mariano in 1751 when he was the president of the Texas Missions for the Santa Cruz College. And while in the midst of all of this work and negotiating with the civil authority and the military authorities, he dared to ask his fellow friars, "How are we doing?" And he gave them a list, about 10 or 11 questions, said, "Please answer this, circle it around, have somebody run it to the next mission." And within about 6 months, he received these responses back. And it's one of the most gritty self-analysis I've seen in a colonial document, that they literally did hold themselves accountable, at least to the standards as they define them. I'd love to show you that. I've got it on my laptop if you want to stick around. I think we're probably out of time. Thank you. All right. Very good.
Thank you very much, Dr. Harrison. So what we're going to do now is proceed to question and answer. We've got a very comfortable, I think, 15 minutes to do so. My colleague from the GLO, Dr. Cardona here, is going to be our mic handler, so we can have a kind of Oprah-type format.
That's right. Wow.
Wow, Oprah. Right up here in the front.
Getting the mic there might be more difficult.
Yeah, you could just pitch it.
Yeah.
There we go.
Thank you both to you. At the beginning, Dr. Wage, you spoke of the Native Indians as being masters of their environment and finding that the life in the missions was totally unnatural to them. These are people that were successful with feeding themselves, their religion, their culture, their language, their dress. Along come the friars, and how, you know, I haven't heard any of this is how they were able to recruit them into the missions when everything was totally, totally different and unknown to them. And I know that also lots of these people died because of the diseases that were brought by the white people from Spain. And I know I went to one of the missions here, and it dawned on me at that time, and I started doing research since then, and that's why I'm here today, is for more of this transparency is how they recruited these Indians and how they treated them. And there's one case with Father Junipero Serra in California, and a lot of the Native descendants complaining about the treatment that their ancestors received from them. But one of the missions here said that you said 250 people in the mission, and if not, then you've got to go recruit, you know. And so, to me, that's why the soldiers were around, for that purpose. And that the walls were not just for protection, but to me, to keep the people enslaved. And then one of the missions here said they ran low and they sent the soldiers south of the state, towards the valley, to bring back more people. And I'm thinking, they didn't come willingly. I don't see how they could have come willingly back to a mission or to be brought into a mission. So I'd like more transparency on that.
You basically have three different ways in which Native Americans came to the mission. What you call recruit is two nicer words. They hunted and gathered. They went out there in the what they call Tierra Adentro, the interland, and gather people, whether they were willing to come or not. But a lot of groups also ask to enter the missions. particularly after around the 1740s, when the Apache came down, and the Apache very much like the Spaniards, and I like the Apache very much. That's a condition in what I'm going to say. But the Apache were like the Spaniards; they came to conquer. They did not take no for an answer. So anybody that was in the way either joined the Apache or got out of the way. So a lot of groups at that period of time, between the 1740s all the way to the 1760s, asked actually, and we have documentation of that, asked to enter the mission. Mm-hmm. And so did it voluntarily. There are other groups that it's complicated how they did it. It apparently, the process was more like a leader, quote unquote, and we're not talking about leaders. We're talking about people by consensus that convinced the others to actually follow them, okay? It's not, they could not order people to do things. They just have to make them accept their version of events. And in some cases, those people, those quote unquote leaders, took their groups in. Okay, so there was a whether or not they actually knew what would happen and how life would change and so forth. It's doubtful that they did, particularly in the beginning. But you got really these three different models, and you can never say that Native Americans did not enter the missions voluntarily, because they did. You can also not say that Native Americans were entered voluntarily, because a lot of them came in by force. Okay. Yep. So it's a tricky business in different times, different ways.
Yes. Sure. The missions were subsidized by the state of Spain. They didn't have this money to get everything, their capitation, the money to a point,
yeah.
And following your path, Dr. Harrison, on up, uh-huh. To me, the Spanish conquistadors were benefited by, to me, the food that
Well, they did to a point. One of the things to keep in mind is that even as successful as a mission might be, if we compare it to an hacienda, it still was no hacienda, unless a few exceptions of the Jesuits and just a few others. And so scarcity was often more the norm than excess or surplus food. We're also talking about a very long time period. So by the time we get to the second half, effectively, of the colonial period, that adelantado or conquistador mindset has backed off a bit, and it's into more of a state-sponsored model. You're correct in providing for the cienoda or the payment, the annual payment to support the missions. Now that said, the documents are rife with a couple of things. First, the support not being provided. To get to the royal box, the bank effectively in Saltillo was quite an undertaking for the Texas friars late in the colonial period. And many years went by where they got nothing. And so their procurators, the people who supplied the missions, effectively had nothing to work with and had to dip into other accounts. And yet, the whole idea and the legal construct was that, yes, indeed, the crown would support them. And I would go back to the statement about using mendicants. They also, when they had Jesuits before 1767, they also liked Jesuits because Jesuits knew how to make money. And in fact, the Baja California missions were supported by donors, private donors, to the Jesuits and not the crown, through the Pious Fund. Whereas the Franciscans lived in a state of dependency quite often for that funding.
Which the Franciscans and the crown abducted at the end when the Jesuits were thrown out.
Yes.
That was part of the deal. We get the money, you guys get out of here.
There was some temporary happiness with that acquisition.
That's the way to put it, yes.
Okay. I recall Dr. White saying there was little information about how these missions actually got started and who built them, but it just seems sort of beyond belief that you could just have a couple of people from the church, a couple soldiers, and a bunch of Indians build these structures when they're that beautiful, that long-lasting. They're still here today. And the detail work on some of this. So what's if you don't have solid records, how do you think these things got built, and where did the specialists come from? Ancient astronaut theorists is part of the answer.
We know where. Yeah, we know where to go. It's just a pain to go there, and to go, you got to go to the accounts, because that's one of the things that people could not fake. I mean, they may not have been, you know, they may not verbalize or write about all these things that they assume you know, or they don't want to talk about, or we might as well not go there, and all the other stuff, okay? But one thing that they have to do is the accounts. The accounts have to detail everything to the penny. And so the only process is go to the accounts. But if you think that's easy, you've got another thing coming. It's really, really hard. They are a mess sometimes. It's really hard to be able just to translate them and so forth. It's also extremely tiring because it's number after number after number, and you have to go to the dictionary to figure out what this is and what that is. So yes, but that the only way to find the answers to this is that way, because you will find imports of things that would not fit.
Right.
And therefore you've got, you know, if you see paints and things like that all coming together, you know that somebody, and maybe there are salaries paid that you are finding, but it's minutia work, okay.
Yeah. One of the best examples of documenting that is New Mexico. In the provincial records for the 18th century, the supply is fairly well documented. Of course, it was destroyed for the 17th century largely because of the Pueblo Revolt of 1680. But I did just come across, it was shared with me, and it's accessible, but as Mariah said, very difficult to get into to do. But I have just recently seen the account books for San Fernando College as relating to activities in Sonora and Upper California. The thing that struck me was that at the point in time that this picks up, they were actually saving money each year because they expected the Crown to default on its obligations to support the missions. And so the ideal, and this is expressed in the visitation reports that accompany this, was to keep as much of a surplus in the college as possible because it could be very dicey in years to come. And depending on the administration and the viceregal authorities that were operating at the time, they may not see the funds to operate the missions that they had committed themselves to do.
You also have to think, which is really important when you're looking at the broad picture, that Texas ends when California, and I'm talking about Alta, I'm not talking about Baja, okay?
Right.
Which Baja begins the process of missions, okay? And then and Alta takes over later on.
1769,
but when, right. But it's when Texas ends that California begins. So somebody, mostly Franciscans in this case, are going, because it's who takes over in Alta, are going to benefit from the mistakes, the errors. They have a whole record of things that happen in Texas and in other places to backtrack. It helps.
Are these priests, to some extent, Renaissance men, or do they know a lot about a lot, or is there a lot of specialists coming in at the beginning?
Well, some of the friars did spend time studying ancient examples and medieval examples of construction, but not many. I've analyzed three of the friars' holdings, or not friars, but three of the college's holdings, Querétaro, Zacatecas, and San Fernando in Mexico City. And there are examples of how to build a building. And it goes all the way back to the ancients. I mean, this is a scholastic synthesis that they are reading. However, practical manuals, there were a few. And there is a tradition among the provincial Franciscans of having some of these available in the early days in the 16th century. But a lot of that, I would agree with Dr. Wade, it does not translate up into places like this. There's a few examples, the Rose Window, for example, at San Jose, you know, that was done by a professional. Mm-hmm. There are some of those examples.
Do you want to go right here? Yeah,
we have time for about two
more. Sure, yeah. About two more, probably.
The terms that we normally hear and apply when we're talking about what you're talking, describing the people, Tejas Indians, Tejas tribe, and that was, from what I understand, that word was introduced by the Spanish, just like the word Mexico was introduced by the Spanish. So when we're saying, I think it's confusing when we're saying the people that were Tlaxcalan from Mexico, they were indigenous people of,
yeah.
Right? So why do we keep on using those terms And us out here are going to continue using Indian and Tejas, and there was, well, Tejas is for Spanish and Texas is in English, when I know that both words were introduced by the Spanish.
The word Tejas was used by the natives themselves when they first encountered the first expedition, the colonial expeditions. It just meant friends, okay? Yep. But it was a tribute, and it was they became named after the use that they said, hey, you know, we're not enemies, don't shoot, don't do anything. Tlaxcala is a region with Tlaxcaltecans, they live there. So it's what you have in Texas is very much similar to what you had and still have in Amazonia. You have an enormous amount of groups with several families of languages, of which we know almost nothing. There is at least in the record, there are 420 named groups. Some of them may actually be the same group named by different folks. I ask him and he says, you know, I'm from northern France, and somebody comes along and says, he actually not, you know, is that from Dunkirk or whatever. You know, so what happens is that different people gave different names. So you have, but you still have a lot of groups. And just like somebody today during the first talks, I think Andres Tejerinas actually talked about the fact, named a few groups. Well, nobody knows what the Payaya is. Nobody knows where the Inagua is. You know, so if I start spewing names like that, all I do is create more confusion. I'll ask my students to do that, but for an audience, it's almost impossible. So what we do know is call them. If they prefer to be, they can call themselves whatever they wish. In my case, I call them Native Americans because I don't want to call them Indians, because the continent of India already existed. And if I go to the library, I look for India, and I have a whole bunch of shelves that have to do with India. So I just call them Native Americans. Since I deal with the early ones, there is no confusion.
One more, Lisa.
Dr. Wade, I didn't really get if you came to a conclusion of where they learned the skills like that.
It's my understanding
that when Olivares came up to establish the Alamo, that he brought quite a few Indians with him.
Would you mind if I correct you, please?
Yes, no,
When Olivares came out to establish San Antonio de Valero.
Yes, I'm sorry.
Please, because it's gonna be a lot of time before it becomes the Alamo. And it's just, we always forget that it's actually a mission, and I try.
It's gonna be on the test at the end.
Yes, sir, yes. No, I don't have any answers for you. It's something that intrigues me, and what I found out is that I have way more questions than answers. And what it did to me was actually say to you, "Gee, you got to go put the nose in this and find the answers." So I do have a whole bunch of ideas, and also have to do with the socialization processes that this end up creating. And so I'm gonna grind on this. But no, I don't really have an answer.
Well, I guess I'm wondering if they had not learned the skills from somebody else, and then they brought those skills, the Indians themselves might have been the teachers of those kids.
There are a few records of bringing indigenous peoples up from the central part of Mexico that did have the skills of a Ladino or a Spanish-style culture. And that's one reason why we speculate about the folks we've already mentioned, but the documents are scarce. We can assume, as Dr. Wade said, that there are patterns of socialization that is passing on skills, but that is not documented to any level that we would like.
Yeah, I found some documents from West Texas that actually are not, that have nothing to do with this book, that have to do with the other book. And there is one, it's early on, it's before any missions, and before actually they are in Texas at all. And one of the things, and it's a guy that's trying to establish some colonies, some groupings way south of the Rio Grande. And one of the things that is discussed in there is the importation of Tarascans because of the skills of people from Puebla, because of those of Michoacan, yeah, because of these skills. So that may very well have happened. We just do not have the records yet. I mean, they may be out there, but I haven't.
The frustrating thing is, say, in the case of, you know, we have procured building materials and we send them up, you have to assume somebody's waiting there to use them.
Yeah.
But we don't have it. Yeah, sure.
All right. Unfortunately, that's the end of our session.
For anybody here that hasn't had a chance to go to any of the beautiful churches outside of Puebla, Mexico,
yeah,
the Sugar Rest, you know, you can see that the Indians built them because the Baroque carvings are, the people look like their angels look like Indians in the moment before.
True.
So we know they were trained.
Yep.
There, yes.
Yeah. And the records are,
there is a record there.
Yeah. 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 There, yeah. 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 Thank right. you.
Thank you so folks. Much, everyone, to the presenters, to TAMU Press, for you for coming. Thank you very much.